Arctic sea ice forms when water temperatures drop below minus 1.8 degrees Celsius. That's 28.7 degrees Fahrenheit. But freezing doesn't happen instantaneously. The upper 100 or so meters of sea need to reach this temperature. And so, as the Arctic winter approaches, it can take a while for enough heat to be lost to the atmosphere before freezing starts. When it does, the water begins to fill with spindly crystals called frazzles, just a few millimeters wide, that bob freely in the water. Within a few days, the frazzles conglomerate into sheets. In calm water, the sheets are transparent wafers that bend and roll with the waves. These are called nilus. They can be so thin they give the water a greasy appearance, and are sometimes called grease ice. If the water is choppy, on the other hand, the ice forms rafts that crash into each other, rounding them into thick disks called pancake ice. Eventually, these sheets solidify into floes. These might be smooth and flat, or rough and uneven. Gradually, more ice accumulates on the underside to form first-year ice. First-year ice can be up to a meter thick. It's salty, brittle, relatively easy to melt, and relatively easy to crack. Wind and water currents drive the floes into one another. Where they crash together, they form pressure ridges that rise up to 12 meters high and extend even further below the surface. When ice sheets break apart, they leave narrow cracks called flaw leads. Elsewhere, winds or columns of rising warm water open up larger areas known as polynyas. Polynyas are like giant lakes in the middle of the ice, expanding and contracting in size. One of the largest in the Arctic, the North Water Polynya, adjacent to Greenland in northern Canada, can cover up to 85,000 square kilometers. That's about 53,000 square miles. Flaw leads and polynyas are crucial to life in the Arctic. Algae and other types of phytoplankton flourish here. Arctic cod, seals, walrus, polar bears, and other animals feed here. Indigenous populations rely on flaw leads and polynyas for navigation and hunting. Some of the world's most northern communities live on the edge of the North Water Polynya. As the ice freezes and becomes thicker, it expels salt into the water below. That salt mixes with water from the Atlantic, causing the water to sink and eventually return south. This movement is a crucial part of the global circulation of ocean water that helps regulate Earth's temperature. Salt is expelled upwards, too, in the form of frost flowers. These are delicate crystalline structures composed of salt and water vapor that freeze in the cold air. Frost flowers used to be rare, but changing conditions in the Arctic have made them more abundant, with some flows of first-year ice covered in the structures. Clouds often form above flaw leads and polynyas. It's thought that frost flowers may play a role in the formation of small aerosol particles around which vapor condenses to make clouds. Clouds deposit snow on the ice surface. Frost flowers can trap blowing snow, thickening the snowfield. Ice that survives the first year thickens into what's called multi-year ice. Most of the salt has been expelled, making the ice much harder and resistant to breakage and melting. Multi-year ice can be 2 to 4 meters thick. It used to be that much of the Arctic Ocean was covered in multi-year ice. Unfortunately, there is almost none of the thickest multi-year ice remaining in the Arctic Ocean. Today, it's almost all fragile first-year ice, which is taking longer and longer every year to form. The main reason for this is that ice is white and reflects the sun's radiation back out into space, keeping the Arctic cool. But darker, open water absorbs heat. Global warming is heating the Arctic, melting the sea ice, creating more dark open water, and causing even more ice to melt. There's many other complex factors contributing to the Arctic warming and causing sea ice to be lost. Wind and wave action, storms and changing water currents are just some examples. Clouds too play a role. Although they can reflect sunlight, just like ice, in the wintertime clouds act as a blanket, trapping warmth. Global warming is most visible in the summertime, when more and more ice melts. But the Arctic is actually warming fastest in the winter. It is predicted that at the current warming rate, the Arctic could lose all summer sea ice, at the latest by 2100, or as early as 2030. But the complex Arctic climate system has already become so destabilized and weakened that it's more susceptible than ever to storms and other extreme weather events. Some scientists warn that we should already be prepared for an extreme event that wipes away almost all sea ice.